Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Welcome to our service this morning of Holy Communion on the second Sunday of the Easter season. During our service this morning, we're going to be thinking about the Great Commission, so I'll be talking about that later on in the service. And so for now, I just want to encourage us to respond really confidently and with joy with these words at the end of the time, as we're still in Easter and right through until we get to Pentecost. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia. Praise the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ.
He has given us the new hope and hope. He has raised Jesus from the dead.
God has claimed us as his own.
He has brought us out of darkness. He has made us light to the world.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
And we pray this prayer together. God of the resurrection,
roll away the stone in my heart, that the light of your life might stream in. God of the resurrection, call my name in the garden, that I might know you are close, that I might know that you are calling me to follow you afresh, this day, as I worship you, Lord. Show me how to live in the knowledge of your resurrection, Jesus. Amen.
A short video clip now to help us start thinking about this topic of the Great Commission.
After Jesus had been raised from the dead, he met with his disciples over the next 40 days. During that time, Jesus told them even more about God's kingdom. Then Jesus' 11 disciples went to a mountain in Galilee. Jesus had told them to go there. When the disciples saw Jesus, some of them worshipped, but some of the disciples still doubted. Then Jesus went up to them and said, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Jesus is God the Son. He always had authority. But after Jesus died on the cross and rose from the dead, God gave him all authority in heaven and on earth. Jesus is the King over all creation, and he rules over God's kingdom." Jesus gave the disciples and everyone who follows him a job to do. He said, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel. Make disciples of people from every nation." A disciple is a follower. Jesus wants his followers to tell people all over the world how to be rescued from sin and death by trusting in Jesus' death and resurrection. Then those people who believe would become disciples of Jesus. Jesus also said, "Baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." New disciples are cleansed from sin by Jesus' blood. When believers are baptized, they show the world that they have turned away from sin and trusted in Jesus as their Savior. Jesus continued, "Teach them to obey everything I have commanded you." Disciples who love Jesus will want to obey him. Then Jesus said, "Remember this, I am always with you until the very end." The good news about what Jesus has done to rescue us from our sins is too great to keep to ourselves. Before Jesus went back to heaven, he gave the disciples a job to do. Jesus wants his followers to teach people everywhere about Jesus, so they will trust in him as their Lord and Savior.
Opportunity now for our children and people to go to their activities. So let's just pray for them. So Lord God, and we thank you for each and every person that is part of this church fellowship and family, and we pray now that as they go to their times, that they will just find you in their midst, Lord, just bringing them your joy and the knowledge of your great love for them. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. First, we're going to just spend a few moments reflecting over the past week and realising once again our need for God to intervene and to take us further on in our lives with Him. Upon the world with healing for all, let us come to Him in sorrow for our sins, seeking healing and salvation. Let's respond with the words in bonds. Lord Jesus, you suffered a cruel death on the cross for our redemption, yet we have forgotten your pain and strayed in the realm of the evil you defeated. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you were brought from death to bring us new life, yet we have preferred the comfort of the familiar and the empty promises of a sinful world. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you have ascended to your Father and our Father, your God and our God. Please bear at the right hand of God for our forgiveness and entry into the fullness of His presence. Lord, have mercy.
Lord,
have mercy. Mother God of love and power, forgive us and free us from our sins, heal and strengthen us by His Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. Going into a time of some worship, please stand if you're comfortably able. So lift up the Lord to that.
Oh.
hold your people in our hearts. And so as we come now to explore your word, we pray that we would be open and receptive to what you would tell us personally. Amen. Please take a seat, and Martha's going to bring us up there to a today.
This morning's New Testament reading is taken from Matthew chapter 28, verse 16 through to 20, and is on page 1000 in the church Bibles. The Great Commission. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make the disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And teach them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
What
are
the reading from Carol?
So this reading is taken from Acts chapter 1, which you will find on page 1092. Acts chapter 1. Jesus taken up into heaven. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for my gift, the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For you are baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around him and asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." Matthias chosen to replace Judas. Then the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the hill called the Mount of Olives, a Sabbath day's walk from the city. When they arrived, they went upstairs to the room where they were staying. Those present were Peter, John, James, and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. They all joined together constantly in prayer, along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. In those days, Peter stood among the believers, a group numbering about 120, and said, "Brothers and sisters, the scripture had to be fulfilled in which the Holy Spirit spoke long ago through David concerning Judas, who served as guide for those who arrested Jesus. He was one of our number and shared in our ministry. With the payment he received for his wickedness, Judas bought a field. There he fell headlong. His body burst open and all his intestines spilled out. Everyone in Jerusalem heard about this, so they called that field in their language Akeladama, that is field of blood. Paul said, Peter, it is written in the book of Psalms, may his place be deserted, let there be no one to dwell in it, and may another take his place of leadership. Therefore it is necessary to choose one of the men who have been with us the whole time the Lord Jesus was living among us, beginning from John's baptism to the time when Jesus was taken up from us. From one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection. So they nominated two men, Joseph, called Barsabbas, also known as Justus, and Matthias. Then they prayed, Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which of these two you have chosen to take over this apostolic ministry, which Judas left to go where he belongs. Then they cast lots, and the lot fell to Matthias, so he was added to the 11 apostles. This is the word of the Lord.
And this one we're going to refer to both of those readings fairly equally. So then it's Matthew 28 and the final few verses and Acts 1. There's Bibles under the chairs in front of you if you do want to refer as we go along. So just a moment of prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you for Easter. Lord, we thank you that you went willingly to the cross. And we praise you, Almighty Father, Lord, that you raised Jesus and that we can know in our hearts that he is alive. In Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. So as I was saying near the start of the service, this morning we're going to start thinking about the Great Commission that Jesus gave to those first followers that applies to us who follow and after them. And we're going to think about that week on week, really, as we head towards looking at Acts in quite a bit of detail. And we're going to look at Acts on Sunday evenings as well next month. So first I'll tell you a bit of a story. So a young boy built a model ship. He glued all of the pieces together and he worked on it for hours. And it was really perfect. Every detail was there, right down to the tiny little sailors standing there on the deck of this model. And then he put it into a glass case. He wouldn't let his brother play with it. It just needed to be kept so perfect and kept very, very safe. And then sometime later, his parents bought a real boat so that they could spend some weekends away sailing in the harbour nearby where they lived. And they loved it at first, but found later it was a lot of work to maintain it. Boat owners will tell you that the happiest day is when they get the boat, and then the second happiest day after that is often when they get it sold off to the next owner. So at first, his parents had used it a lot, and then later they used it less and less. It was expensive. After a few months, they went to spend a day, having not used it much at all over that time, and they found that there was all barnacles growing on the side of the boat, there was algae all over it, and the motor was just absolutely dead. A real boat is only kept alive and in good shape by being used. The two boats have to be treated and looked at in opposite ways. The model boat was preserved by being kept safe, whereas a real boat was kept safe by being used. It was made alive through use. And church families are a lot like a real boat. They're only kept in shape by being used time and time again. The church body is the people, that's me and you, all of us in this place, from the youngest to the oldest, who need to keep on being active. If we have a mentality of preserving everything, then eventually the body falls into disrepair and it's no good at all. But if we have a mindset of being active and serving the community, more and more we will find energy, calling, passion and love that is alive. As Peter writes in his first letter in the New Testament, as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. And in our gospel reading this morning from Matthew 28, we see these wonderful words, that Jesus gave, that have become known throughout the church's history as the Great Commission. Jesus said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth is given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always, to the end of the age." And right at the start of us coming to explore what this can mean for us at St. James's this morning, I sense that there's two things that the Lord wants us to know, and then one thing that he wants us to be committing to. And so first, and these two things that he wants us to know. So first, I sense the Lord is saying to all of us that he wants us to know personally that there is so much evidence that Jesus rose from the dead. And this has been mentioned as part of our small group meetings, and it's been touched on last week as well. But let's just think about it. Let's just take this in more today. So then from Acts 1 and verse 3, that after Jesus suffered, he presented himself to the early disciples and gave them many convincing proofs that he was alive. We're told that these proofs were given over 40 days, during which time he talks with them as well about the kingdom of God. 40 days. Right now we're marking that period of time between when Jesus rose and when he ascended and the Spirit came. Let's try to imagine this morning what it would have been like for those early disciples there and then, receiving for themselves firsthand these convincing proofs. Acts 1:3, it tells us that one of the primary things that Jesus did with his disciples in those 40 days of being with them prior to his ascension was that he presented himself. So how did he do this? Well, we know that he ate with them, as he did with Cleopas and the unknown disciple walking on the road to Emmaus. And he fed the disciples by the Sea of Galilee. And Jesus invited his disciples also to touch and to come close to him as well, to experience tangibly that he had risen. And we know that those disciples, sadly, they went after that time to suffer a great deal and to die for never ceasing to tell others that it is true. Jesus rose and he is Lord and the way to God for everyone who will submit to him. So let's move from imagining what they went through and then consider our personal experience. Let's consider these 40 days that we're now in. How is the Lord Jesus meeting with us each day? How is he encountering us and showing himself to us to be real? How have we experienced his presence over this week? And how might we embrace doing that in the week to come? How has he fed us and ministered to us during this critical time, we would say, in the history of the world, with once again so much conflict going on as we think of Ukraine? And then as we think of hardships closer to home, how are we finding that his presence, his resurrection power, is a reality for us? For me, very much been sensing that the Lord has been renewing for us as a church sure dreams and promises, concrete promises that together we will keep on breaking new ground as we chip away at the mission and see more of the vision that God will give to us as a community. And the challenge that I believe that the Lord has for all of us in respect of convincing proofs that He rose again is for us to not keep that to ourselves, but to be able to talk about the practical and logical proofs that have been given to those first disciples. Knowing that after Jesus rose again, He ate and He drank with His disciples and He spent time with them talking about God's kingdom. Knowing that they later went to their depths for refusing to deny that this was true. Why wouldn't we want to share these things? Getting into a conversation along these lines with people in our lives, it is a lot easier than we might think, since people are quite intrigued when we say to them that there are some logical and practical proofs that Jesus rose again. It does depend on the person, of course. For some of us, we know here today that we had a personal connection, and I'm very much in that category. I had a personal connection with Jesus before I needed to look at the practical proofs. But we know that there's lots of Christians as well, like C.S. Lewis, who looked first at the evidence and that then led them to a personal connection. So this can be very useful as we talk to people. And it doesn't have to be over the top, it can just be really chilled and laid back. So right, I said that there are two things that we need to know. The first being that there are proofs and evidence that Jesus rose again. And then the second thing to know is that we have power from God to tell people. This is not something that is in our own strength. We don't have to rely on ourselves. We see as we look at Acts 1 and verse 8 that the disciple Luke recorded that Jesus said, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." The reason that I say that it's a task for us to know that we have power from the Holy Spirit is this. So let's just use an analogy to explain this. So suppose a large electric power company would offer free electric service to all homes within a 10-mile radius of the power plant. An electric power to these homes would be a free gift from the power company. And then suppose several of these homes were transported and taken out of the radius of about 10 miles. Would they still be eligible to receive the free electricity? Well, no, they wouldn't, because that wasn't the agreement. The gift of free electric power would only apply to those living within that particular area. And in a similar way, our maintaining of a close relationship with God is key to us knowing that we have that power. So our knowledge is not like reading in a book, it's personal knowledge as we draw close to God and receive more of that Holy Spirit power each day. And so that brings me on to the one thing above all of us that we are to commit to is we know these things, as we know that there's evidence and know personally that we can have this power of the Holy Spirit. And I believe the Lord is saying to us as we go into this new time, heading towards Pentecost, that we are to relentlessly join together in prayer, to commit to praying with one another in all times and all places in different ways. Let's look at verses 12 to 14 of Acts 1. It tells us then the apostles, they returned to Jerusalem from the hill called the Mount of Olives, a Sabbath day's walk from the city. And when they arrived, they went upstairs And we're told that some of the early disciples were there, Peter, John, James, etc. And they all joined together constantly in prayer, along with the women, Mary, and with his brothers. So there were lots of them there in that room. You see, at this point, Jesus had returned to reign with Father God, and knowing that the person of the Holy Spirit was going to be with them soon to bring them this power, those early followers, they decided to unite together, to come together to pray. Something that this upper room was the same place where the disciples shared their final meal. But that's a secondary sort of matter, really. And what's most important to us is that they did all gather together. And we know that there was quite a few of them, as we're told in the next verse. So they weren't sitting on their laurels. They weren't sort of thinking, well, you know, the Holy Spirit's going to come anyway. Isn't he? So let's just enjoy some meals, let's rest, let's take life easy, and let's just just carry on life as though nothing much is going to happen. No, they didn't do that at all. They came together and they decided that praying together was a really important thing to do. We're told that they joined together constantly in prayer. They carried on with real perseverance in prayer in those days. And this praying together put them more in touch with one another, as well as with God. And so we know it's true that when we pray together in our midweek small groups, on the Alpha course, and all of this, it builds connection and it gives rise to unity. Praying together is such a key thing that sets us apart from kind of just a good fellowship gathering. It causes us to become distinctively Jesus-shaped as we commit to praying with one another. And what we want as a church from there is to increasingly take opportunities to be praying together, to take us beyond simple fellowship, to that experience of being grafted together by His Spirit. So we know that the apostles, they were not alone. We're told that there were the women, there was the brothers, and there was quite a few coming together, as I was saying. 120 even were there in that place, but there has not got to be a large number of us to be active in praying together. There might be 20 or 30, and there might be 40 or 70. And as a friend of mine often brings up, Jesus said, wherever two or three are gathered in His name, the Lord God is there in the midst of them. Jesus is there. And we need to just be reminded of this. It might be something we've heard a lot before, but it can be something that we can take to a deeper level if we would only be open to it. So you might be unexpectedly meeting a friend by the bus stop, and they share with you that they have a need or they have something that they want to change in their life. So why not be bold and gentle, but bold, and say, well, and then, shall we pray together about that? Shall we talk to God about that thing? It really doesn't have to be over the top. And just pray simply from the heart and finish in Jesus' name, amen. Or you might be in your midweek group and you've not prayed much aloud before, but when you experience like being prompted by the Spirit and think, okay, it doesn't matter, I'm just going to go for it, and see what will happen as you do that. See how the Lord can bless you through that. And even in the small group meeting, If you feel strongly that the meeting should stop and we should pray about a certain thing, then just say to Liz, Anne, Pete, Sarah or me in that group, we won't mind at all, we will just stop and we will pray with you about what you're feeling so strongly is on your heart. And finally, I want to encourage you today, because we're going to go towards a really special time in our church's life called Thy Kingdom Come. We did take part in this last year, but we was quite restricted, and so we had the prayer journals that some of you remember having, and the reflection booklets. But this year, we're going to be able to have more of a chance to write more of this. So we're going to set up an interactive prayer room behind this main altar for the chancel and the side prayer room. And this will have different activities to just help us to discover more about praying together and praying as individuals and just taking our prayer life further. And that'll be the 10 days between Ascension Day and Pentecost Sunday. So I just pause. Let's just be open to God's presence and listen in the quietness. And then I'll pray for us. Lord Jesus, we love you for who you are and for all that you mean to us. And we want this to always be more important to us than any practical proofs and evidence, Lord, that you rose again. But we do thank you that we have that evidence. And so we ask, Lord, for the courage to share that with others. And Lord, we thank you so that we have your Holy Spirit as we look forward to celebrating that your Spirit came. And Lord, thank you that you have given us one another, Lord, wherever we are, out and about, at our small groups, Lord, here in church, Lord, give us that same desire to join together in prayer. Lord, take us deeper in prayer with you for your glory. Lord, cause us to not hold back from letting you flood and increasingly into our lives. In your glorious name, Amen. I'm going to stand if we come to be able to affirm our faith. We share together as God's family, remembering all that we believe. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And in a time of prayer.
Let us pray for the church and for the world, and let us thank God for his goodness. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you promised through your Son, Jesus Christ, to hear us when we pray in faith. Everlasting God, we pray for all who are commissioned and called to work as leaders and prophets in your church, and for all those seeking God. We pray for a greater discernment of your presence and your will in our Christian communities, and a clearing away of all that obscures our vision. Help us to be a nurturing parish, to share in your love and draw others to meet you. We also thank you for the times you have rescued and forgiven us, never giving up and leading us into deeper faith. Lord, in your mercy,
hear
our prayer. Dear Father, we pray for all who are fighting against evil, for goodness, truth and justice, for those who make the news, and those whose battles are known only to you. We ask that you send lives of light among the darkness of injustice, corruption and despair, and strengthen those who are already shining their light in dark places. We pray especially for Ukraine, for its people, and for its leaders, that they may seek your wise and godly counsel. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Almighty God, may we walk in prosperity this day, in the power of the one true God, in a manner pleasing to Christ, in the light of the Holy Spirit, in the faith of the patriarchs, the merits of the prophets, the peace of the apostles, the splendor of the saints, in abundance of peace, in praise of the Trinity, with our senses alert, with constant good works, with spiritual powers, and with holy love. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Dear Lord, we bring before you the needs of those whose lives are shadowed by suffering, and pray for all who need courage, support and practical help. Make us willing to be a helping hand. Enable them to draw on your resources and find comfort. We remember those most in this congregation who are ill or housebound, and those known only in our hearts. Our prayer for them and for ourselves is that we may come to know God more surely, to trust in him more deeply, and to realize the Holy Spirit within us all, ever at work, healing, strengthening, and guiding us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Dear Lord, we ask you to comfort those who have lost loved ones, especially Gloria and her family. Give them strength and surround them with your love. Help them to trust in your love and the belief that neither this world or the next can separate them from your care. To believe that life is eternal and your love is immortal. They are now at peace in the unconfined space and joy of heaven. Rejoicing in the fellowship of St. James and all your saints, we commend ourselves and all Christian people to your unfailing love. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son,
our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Continue
the passage of
prayer to pray this prayer on the screen
and set for today. Almighty Father,
You have given your only Son to die for our sins and to rise again to make us right with you. Help us to reject sin and evil, that we may always serve you in pureness of living and truth. Through the merits of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is alive and made with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We share a sign of God's peace among us in marriage, and we're carrying on doing that through signing, so it's peace with, in the moment. So, the risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." Then they were glad when they saw the Lord. Alleluia. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Share a sign of that. Towards celebrating communion, we're going to sing again. If you're comfortably able, let's stand together.
Jesus.
of your risen power that work in our lives. Amen. Please take a seat. Just to say, for those in August that are not at this time seeing the community for whatever reason, just drawing faith, whatever, that's absolutely fine. Just come forward at the point when I'm distributing the wafers and put your hands by your sides and I'll pray a prayer of blessing for you. Yeah. The Lord be with you.
The Lord be with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let's give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
right and praise. Almighty God, the Father of us all, your face is turned towards your world. In love, you gave us Jesus, your Son, to rescue us from sin and death. And now we give you thanks because, in fulfillment of your promise, you pour your Spirit on us, filling us with your gifts, leading us into all truth, and uniting peoples of many tongues in the confession of one faith. You give us power to proclaim your gospel to all nations and serve you as a royal priesthood. Therefore, we join our voices with angels and archangels and with all those in whom the Spirit dwells to proclaim the glory of your name, forever praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory, and hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, hosanna in the highest.
Father of all, we give you thanks for every gift that comes from heaven. To the darkness, Jesus came as your light, with signs of faith and words of hope. He touched the untouchables with love and washed the guilty clean. This is his story.
This is our song. Hosanna in the highest.
The crowds came out to see your son, yet at the end they turned on him. On the night he was betrayed, he came to table with his friends to celebrate the freedom of your people. This is his story.
This is our song. Hosanna in the highest.
Jesus blessed you, Father, for the food. He took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and said, this is my body, given for you all. And then Jesus gave thanks for the wine. He took the cup, gave it, and said, this is my blood, shed for you all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. This is our story.
This is our song. Hosanna in the highest.
Therefore, Father, with this bread and this cup, we celebrate the cross on which you died to set us free. Defying death, he rose again, and is alive with you to plead for us and all the world. This is our story.
This is our song.
Hosanna in the highest. Lord, send your Holy Spirit on us now, that by these gifts we may feed on Christ with open eyes and hearts on fire. May we and all you share this food, offer ourselves to live for you, and be welcomed at your feast in heaven, where all creation worships you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessing and honour and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. Being made one by the power of the Spirit, as Jesus our Saviour has taught us, so we pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory of God, now and forever. Amen.
Draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ that you gave for dead, and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
us praying for Latin communion. Lord, we have broken
your bread and received your love. By the power of your Spirit, keep us all right in your love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
So we come towards the close of our service for this morning. We've got a few pieces of church family news that start off with what children and people have been doing whilst we were exploring the Great Commission.
Yeah, we looked at the Great Commission this morning and we spoke about how we can tell people about Jesus today, that Jesus' instructions for the disciples is still real to us today. And we made a little domino tail thing to show the knock-on effects that you tell one person about Jesus and they tell someone else and they tell someone else. And then we drew around our feet, Jamesy's waving his foot, we had to wave your foot. As a symbol of going out into the world and wrote one of the Bible verses from Matthew on it.
That's good. Just to make you aware, we've got the annual church meeting on Sunday the 8th of May, so that's 2 weeks today, during the 10 o'clock service. So most of the stuff will be taken care of through the reports. We will be doing some electing the people for the church council and whatnot. But on the whole, that service is about celebrating the church year that's gone past and looking towards the new one to come. And there'll be reports publicly available in church next Sunday, and it'll go out on the email as well. And we'll make sure anybody who isn't able to come right now will get one through their door as well. We have four nominations. If you'd like to serve in this way, speak to me or Roger or Margaret, and we can talk to you a little bit more about what it means to serve on the church council. It's an exciting role to be on the PCC because it's about thinking together about our vision, the vision the Lord would give to us going forward and year upon year. And it's also a chance for us to involve decision making around the key resources of the church, around people and finances and how our church buildings are used. Please listen to God, and if that is something that you might want to get involved with, and just speak to me, even if you think, oh, I've never done anything like that before, it would be wonderful to speak to you about it. Finally, we've got some banns of marriage to publish. So I've published the banns of marriage between Robert Gordon Carpenter and Sharon Louise Truss. This is for the third time of asking. If anyone knows any reason in law as to why these persons might not marry, then you are to declare it. Let's just say a prayer for Robert and Sharon. Lord, we pray for Robert and Sharon that they would just know the power of your love for them, that would just root them and establish them increasingly in you. And Lord, we pray that they would look forward with eager anticipation to the day of their marriage. And Lord, know that you will keep on travelling beside them beyond. In Jesus' name, Amen.
Yeah.
Oh, and you've yeah, Carol's got
sorry,
you've got an
yeah, it's just the 7th of May at the Malvern Festival. I still have a spare ticket if anybody would like to go.
Yeah, the Malvern Festival on the 7th of May, if anyone would like to go speak to Carol afterwards. There's just one other thing. We're thinking at the moment about how we communicate via an email with our current members and the wider local community. If you've got any ideas you would like to feed into this, please speak to Dennis or myself. We're just looking at how the church notice sheet and the email quality serve different purposes and how we could sort of come up with maybe something that's one potentially. But that's something that just to keep considering. So we're going to sing as we come towards the close of the service. We have a shining light, please stand if you come to the aisle.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.